Good morning and welcome to church this morning. We're very glad to see everyone here today on this nice fall morning. Glad to see you. Well, glad that you're watching in online this morning. We have a couple of announcements. BB Gun Target Shoot is coming up Sunday, October 22nd, 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. You could sign up online for that. If there are any guys here, any young kids that need someone to shoot with them, we have some men that are available, and so don't feel left out, but we encourage all men to bring out their kids with them on that day, and we're looking forward to a nice shoot on that day. Also, Assist is a national ministry within our Caris Fellowship. It seeks to help churches with planting and revitalization, and there will be a banquet to support Assist, but to look at and see what Assist does and is doing within our Grace Brethren or Caris Fellowship, and that'll be at Grace Fellowship at Lamersville on November 9th, and you can sign up at our website for that.
Parents, just a heads up that this Wednesday night we will not be having our regular kids clubs. There is regular youth, so the youth kids just come as normal, but instead of having our regular kids clubs, we have family fun night this week. So we would encourage parents, grandparents, bring your elementary and preschool kids out. We're not going to be checking in, so you won't come in these doors. You'll come in the basement entrance and go down to the fellowship hall, and we're going to have family game night. We have snacks and board games and lots of fun things for us to do from 7 to 8. This is not a drop-off night, so parents, you do have to have an adult to stay with your kids. And finally, Light Up the Night is coming soon. The end of this month, we are collecting candy out in the lobby for anyone that would like to drop off candy. And just a little summary for you of what Light Up the Night is for those of you that are newer. Every year on the last Thursday of October, our community has Community Trick-or-Treat Night. And if you've ever been around for bargain days, Community Trick-or-Treat Night looks just like that. There are literally people everywhere in town. And so as a church, we want to be a very bright light on that night. So we turn on our lights, and literally the community comes to us, which is a really cool thing. Last year, we had over 900 people come through our line, and let me tell you, that takes a lot of candy. So we would love to have candy donations. It also takes a lot of people. So we would love to have volunteers, maybe that don't have young kids, so that frees up our young families to go trick-or-treating with their kids. All it takes is to show up that night and stand and pass out candy to families. We also have some hot food that we serve, and so we have some tables we set up and invite the community members to come and sit down and have a chat with us. So if you would like to come and visit with folks, that would be very welcome. We do need some people coming early that day to help set up and staying late that night to help tear down. So if you would be available that evening, please come and talk to me or call the office, and we would love to have some help. And one more time, we do need some candy donations. So please drop off candy out in the lobby.
Ryan.
A couple of youth and young adult related things. First of all, I don't have this on the announcements, but youth this week is student night, completely student led, and it's jersey night, right? Is that jersey night, right? Wear your favorite jersey or a team shirt or something, or wear whatever you want. We don't care. But if you wear a cool jersey and dress up nice, you might get a costume. That is the costume. That's why I need notes to talk, people. A prize. Do we do prizes, Savannah? Okay, thank you for that. Okay. Also, youth and young adult worship night next Sunday evening. We're going to start at 6:30 with some refreshments, worship from 7 to 8. So that's all youth and young adults are welcome to join us for that. And then Forged and Refined, it starts next Sunday. I think I have some slides for that in there, Alex, after this, I believe. Do I? I do. Cool. All right. So that starts next Sunday. If you haven't been here to hear or haven't done this before, just a quick refresher. This gives us practical goals for Bible study, prayer, service, and self-discipline. We have groups available for men and for women if you'd like to connect with a group and don't have one. If you're going to do that, we do need to know that. By the end of today, you can sign up on the church website. That'll give us a week to get you connected with our group leaders. If you have a group, then we just need you to sign up by next week whenever it begins. Again, you can do that on the church website. And go ahead to that next slide there. If you're interested at all, we'd love for you to pick up some information in the lobby. You'll see a green participants guide. It tells you everything that you need to do to be able to participate. Also, we have our Bible reading plan that goes along with our next series in 1 Corinthians on hope. If you're doing Forged and Refined, you need to pick one of those up. That's part of it. If you're not doing Forged and Refined, you're still welcome to pick up a reading plan as we've been doing the past four or five series. We have a reading plan to go along with that. So everything's in the lobby that you might need. It's also all on the church website, so you can check that out too.
All right, please stand and join us for worship.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe.
Thank you.
As many of you know, over the last year, Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church has been blessed by God to be able to send teams to Barbuda to serve down there on mission. We're going to ask the Deal family and Nate to come on up this morning, as well as the elders. They will be deploying. Is that a good word for you guys? Yeah, that's a good word for you guys. You're going to be headed down to Barbuda. They will be leaving on Tuesday to fly down and to serve down there. As I said, this is our fourth team to go down. We sent a team down earlier this year to help build bikes. And then the Yates family went down and did some basketball. And yes, that is Nate. Some of you know Nate. You haven't seen him in a while, but yeah, he's go ahead and wave. That's good. You wave. That's good. The Yates family went down and organized and ran a basketball camp down there. And then the Fredericks and Biddles went down to do some construction and some work. So we're going to be praying over them this morning. But I also want you to be assessing and thinking through the possibility of you going on a trip with us next year. There'll be multiple teams going down next year. You can talk to me for more information. Would encourage you to do that. And what you're seeing here is the second family team to go down. And so maybe you and your family would like to go, or you would like to take them down and to be on mission for Jesus Christ and do some ministry on the work on the island of Barbuda. And so we would encourage you to consider that, think through that, pray through that. And if you have questions, please be sure to contact me and talk to me. And Pastor Rudy, you are going to lead us in prayer. So we'll lay on hands and pray for you guys.
Well, I thought Beckett and Chandler wanted to say a few words. No? Good? Okay. All right, let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this family. Thank you for setting them apart for this work. And I pray for your gracious hand over them, that you would give them protection and guidance and wisdom and just help and strength as they go to serve you. Pray that you would prepare the way for them, that you would prepare those that they're going to come in contact with and interact with. And Lord, we more so just pray for you to prepare the way for the gospel to go forth through this family. I pray that they would point to Jesus in the things that they do, the things they say, and that they would learn much from this, that they would learn much about you, about who you are, about the goodness of what you've done through your son, Jesus, and how you desire your word forth to the nations. So thank you that as a church we get to be a part of what they're doing, and I can't wait to hear of the impact and of the things that you have done in them and through them through this. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you're writing down names, it's Gavin, Lindsay, okay, and you have Talon, Chandler, Beckett, and Nate. And thank you all for coming up. Pastor Brandt, you are going to take us through worship. You're here. All right. Very good.
Well, that's pretty exciting to see. I know they've waited a long time. Their trip was delayed, and so it's exciting they're finally able to do that. It's also good for me to be back here in the Cove. You can hear I picked up a cold or something on the plane, I think, on the way back from Athens this past week. But thanks for your prayers. We do have a big world. God is working, and we wanted to highlight another thing this morning as we prepare to take the offering. So as the ushers come forward, we just want to share with you concerning Emily Greenewald. She's been part of our church family for some time, and she's serving in Cambodia, and she has just come up on her second year anniversary, and so we want to highlight that here in a minute. But let me have a word of prayer for the offering. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity to give. Thank you for how this church has had a heart for missions, and as we give to minister to others as well. We pray that you would just continually bless us. We thank you for your faithfulness to us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So now we're going to watch a video. This is a greeting that Emily has done. She is on a four-year term. She's not able to come home and visit her family for 4 years, so she has been there now 2 years. But many of you know Bill and Cheryl Greenewald and their faithfulness as well here at the church. But this was such an encouraging video that Emily sent to the home ministry team that I'm a part of, and we wanted to share this with your with the entire church family.
Sok sabai, akong chran, ati tan chran, สำหรับคุณยองยังคำเชียร์ระยะผู้เที่ยงโป Hello brothers and sisters, how are you? Thank you for your prayers for me and for Cambodia. May God bless you all. 2 years ago in September, I came to Cambodia, and the time has passed so quickly. My first year was spent in Phnom Penh with a population of around 2,281,000 people. And this past year I've spent in the northeast region of Cambodia, in the province of Ratanakiri, with a population of around 6,080 people. I have loved getting out of the city and into rural Cambodia, the slow pace of life, the animals, except the mosquitoes, and the farming communities remind me of Pennsylvania and has been a joy to see and experience. I'm still learning the Khmer language and I'm still not great at it. There are days when I understand a lot and days when I understand very little. I've had more chances to practice speaking here, but it can be mentally exhausting trying to have conversations with only the words you know. I'm also discovering that even the thought process is different. Please pray that I will have the mental clarity and the fortitude to complete the next level in my language learning by November. I've been so blessed to be able to extend to a longer internship experience in Ratanakiri, where I've been able to walk alongside the missionaries here in their various ministries. The missionaries here work with the Krung and the Brau people, two tribal nationalities. There is an active church, youth group, and two ladies' Bible studies where discipleship is taking place. There is a girls' dorm in our house where we encourage the six girls living here to walk in step with the Lord and to pray that they are able to be equipped for spiritual leadership. It has been so amazing to see them grow in their passion and abilities to serve. One Christian girl who entered our home knew very little about the Bible. Having had the opportunity to soak in the scriptures every night has made such a change in her life. It has been such a privilege to watch. It will be hard to say goodbye. Please pray that I will finish this assignment well. In October, I will be heading back to Phnom Penh for a few weeks to get things organized before moving to my long-term assignment in Snul. I'm hoping to be settled in before Thanksgiving. Snul is a little town that has had missionary presence in it since 2005, but has seen very little fruit for their labor. There's a small church there with a handful of believers. I will be working with a couple who has served in Cambodia for over 20 years, and I'm excited for this new challenge. Right now, they are looking for a house for me to rent. Please pray it will be in the location that God would have me. So be praying that he will prepare me for what he would have me to do there. Thank you so much for your prayers and support. I am just so blessed to have you all doing your part of this mission of lifting up the needs of the people around me to the Lord. May God bless you all.
To hear from Emily and what God's doing through her. Let's stand together. We're going to worship. So sing with us. In the morning as I pray for the day that you have made, I have hope and I have peace, for your presence is with me. So whatever comes my way, Lord, remind me of this grace. I can face it with this hope. Jesus won't forget his own. Jesus holds me safely in his hands. Ever close. His plans. When I can't see the way, I have hope and I have faith day after day. Jesus reigns.
face it with this hope. Jesus won't forget his own. Jesus holds me safely in his hand. Ever goes, he leads me in his plans. When I can't see the way, I have hope and I have faith day after day. Jesus reigns. I pray, Father, help me live your way. Every breath and every word for the glory of the Lord. If the day should test my faith, fill my heart with songs of praise. I can face it with this hope. Jesus won't forget his own. Jesus holds me safely. Good Lord, he leads me in his plans. When I can't see the way, I have hope and I have faith day after day. Jesus reigns day after day. Jesus reigns.
Desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe in this broken generation. It's dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And he's coming back again. We believe. Let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe,
He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And he's coming back again. Let the lost be found and the dead be raised. And the here and now, the loving made. Let the church live loud. Our God will save. We believe.
We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And he's given us new life.
We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And he's coming back again.
Jesus, Jesus.
Father God, we ask that you be the center of our church, center of our lives, our focus on you, Heavenly Father. The world so much tries to distract us from you. I pray that we'll be able to put all of those things aside, Father, and focus on you for what your Holy Spirit is telling us and leading us to do. Use of our gifts, talent, skills, ability, the edification of the church, bringing the church together, Father. I pray that we will focus on you and what you have for us to do this morning. I pray a blessing upon your word, that it would go forth with power and strength this morning. I give this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And children, you are dismissed. Miss Jerry and Miss Erin are there waiting for you. Okay, I'm going to end the suspense right away for you, because many of you wanted to know the story of the 22, the tree, and the raccoon. If you remember last week, Pastor Rudy was announcing the BB gun shoot, and I alluded to a situation, a story in my life with respect to a raccoon, a tree, and a 22. And here's the story very quickly. My dad had given me a 22 when I was very young. I don't remember the age, and I kept pressing him and pressing him and pressing him that I wanted to go woodchuck hunting. I wanted to shoot groundhogs. In New York, I guess we call them woodchucks. I don't know if you call them woodchucks down here, but groundhogs, whatever the case may be. I kept pressing him and pressing him, pressing him. Finally, one day, he took me out in the woods. He said, look at this tree. You see all the holes around them? Those are woodchuck holes. I'm going to put you up in the tree. You go ahead, and when the woodchuck pops his head up and comes out, you go ahead and shoot him. So he boosts me up in the tree. He's holding the gun. I'm up in the tree. I look beside me, and about this far away is a raccoon that lived in the tree. And so the raccoon looked at me, and I looked at him, and I decided, Dad, get me down out of here. And so I came down out of the tree, never went to hunt woodchucks again. So that's the story of the 22, the raccoon, and the tree. Today we will cover the final few verses of chapter 14 in 1 Corinthians. If you have your Bibles, please turn there with me. We've been doing a mini-series on Christ and the church, specifically the spiritual gifts that God provides for us, that God gives to us to use within the church. Over the past few weeks, we've been discussing this important topic, and Paul uses chapter 12, chapter 13, and 14 in 1 Corinthians in his letter. He uses it to help the church understand this whole idea of spiritual giftedness. Next week, we will begin a series entitled The Future Hope of the Church. So we will be going into the final two chapters, 15 and 16. Chapter 15 is one of the most, it's probably the greatest example or greatest discussion with respect to the resurrection that we have in Scripture in chapter 15. So we'll be looking at questions like, how is the resurrection of our bodies from the grave possible? And what does this event look like? And what does a resurrected body comprised of? What does that look like? I know when we typically talk about resurrection, what we think of is the resurrection of Jesus, and rightly so. But we too, as followers of Jesus Christ, will be raised from the dead, and we will spend eternity with our Lord and Savior. And so over the next couple of weeks, we'll be doing a little mini-series there on that. A few years back, we did a sermon series, and Ryan remembers all of this stuff, so he may correct me, but we did a sermon series entitled, You Asked For It. Some of you remember that. We put some boxes out in the back, and we had little pieces of paper there, and you could write down the passage of Scripture that you wanted someone to preach from. Or if you had a question about the Bible or a question about a certain topic, you could write that on there. Or if you had a certain concern or something that was unclear to you, you could write it on the little piece of paper, drop it in the You Ask For It box, and one of the pastors would then be charged to preach a sermon on Sunday morning addressing that particular topic that you asked for. I think we also did music with that too. I'm not really sure at the same time, if you didn't want to do a sermon series, you could say, hey, would you please play Jesus Freak during the morning worship service? And it did happen. Yeah, we did actually do Jesus. What's that? I did the rap. Yes, I did the rap. And not to be done again, but we did the rap. So anyways, you could ask to have a certain song played during the service. And it worked very, very, very well. The reason why it worked well is because Ryan did just such an amazing job of organizing it and keeping it together, making sure that the songs that were suggested were placed properly with the text of Scripture or the sermon topic for that day. Something like that was occurring in the church at Corinth, except it wasn't working so well. You see, for the church at Corinth, every week seemed to be a you asked for it type of a week. Take a look at what Paul writes in verse 26. What then, brothers? Question mark. When you come together, each one of you has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, an interpretation. Let all things be done for building up. Now remember, Paul has just told them in verses 22 to 25 that your services are confusing. When you're all speaking in tongues and an unbeliever comes to the church and they come in and they hear all of this confusion that they don't understand, they think you're crazy and they walk out. All right? And so Paul's telling them, listen, when you come to the service, you're all coming with a different hymn. You want a certain song, or you've got a specific revelation, you're speaking in tongues, interpretation, a prophecy. All of this is causing confusion. Remember now, the Corinthians, this is new. This whole idea of Christianity is new. And so they don't know how to do church. All right? And so Paul's writing to them to help them understand how to get this done and how to do this right. They're not used to meeting together and worshiping. And so as the spiritual giftedness is being expressed, there's confusion. They're not sure exactly what to do. And so Paul writes here in the latter part of chapter 14, he's going to give them some wisdom, some insight, some directives, some commands, so to speak, some instruction how to get their worship and control so that it's doing the right thing. Because the way it is right now in Corinth, it's too chaotic and too confusing. And it's supposed to be worshiping God, edifying each other, and building up the church. So he gives them insights in four areas that are causing confusion within the Corinthian church. So he's going to highlight these four areas. The first one we've talked about over the last several weeks, and I'll just touch on it briefly because the passage speaks of it again, speaking in tongues. If any speak in a tongue, let there be only two or three at most, and each in turn, and let someone interpret. But if there is no one to interpret, let each of them keep silent in church and speak to himself and to God. The first thing to notice there is Paul starts off with the word if. It doesn't mean that every single time they got together, somebody spoke in tongues. It doesn't mean that every church that gets together, that there must be a speaking in tongues. That's not what he is talking about there. All right? If someone is there with a giftedness in the Corinthian church, they should use that giftedness. Notice also, he says, two or three at the most. If the tongues are spoken, that they're not supposed to talk over one another. He says, each in turn. You can't have somebody speaking in tongues over here and another over here. That, again, causes the confusion that Paul is so rightly trying to eliminate here. It should be done in an orderly manner. It should only be done if someone is there to interpret. So the church knew who had the gift of interpretation and who had the gift of tongues, so that if a person came in with the ability to speak in tongues, but there was nobody there to interpret what they were saying, they were to remain silent. The second thing that Paul addresses is the idea of prophecy. Very similar instructions. Let two or three prophets speak and let the others weigh what is said. Evaluate, assess, discern what is said. If a revelation is made to another sitting there, let the first be silent. For you can all prophesy one by one, so that all may learn and all be encouraged, and the spirits of prophets are subject to the prophets. For God is not a God of confusion, but a God of peace. Again, those with the gift of prophecy should limit two or three. Again, confusion. Remember now, we talked about this last week, prophecy is not merely predicting the future. It can be an aspect of that, but in the context here, what Paul is referring to is information or words from God to the people. Think along the lines of teaching and preaching, or saying a word of comfort to another person, or a word of encouragement to another person, from God through you to that person, if you have that specific gift. And the church was supposed to evaluate. That's what he says. He says to weigh what is said. They were to evaluate what was being prophetically spoken, what was being taught. They could ask themselves questions like, because they didn't have the Bible as we have it, wonder what the apostles, how did the apostles approach this thing? How did they deal with this scenario? Or is there anything in the Old Testament writings that would help them to discern this? That's how they would evaluate what was being prophetically spoken. Notice, too, Paul's concern for their respect for one another. Normally, in the church, when a person would speak, they would stand. And so the person would stand up and say, I have a prophetic word, and they would begin to teach. Well, what Paul says here is if someone that is sitting has a revelation, the person that is standing shouldn't take all of the time and hog the show, so to speak. They should eventually bring their words to an end, sit down, and let the person that has the revelation stand. Paul's point is this. Don't take all the time. Don't be long-winded. Speak what the prophetic word is to you, the teaching that you have. Then sit down if another brother has the willingness and the desire to speak. Limit your time. Sit down. Be quiet. Let others lead and let others speak as well. Now remember, all of this was intended to bring order and structure to their worship. And he concludes, God is not a God of confusion, but a God of peace. Okay. Now I have been accused in this pulpit many times of making sure that certain pastors get certain passages of scriptures, the more difficult, challenging topics, okay? All right, the third step here, the third thing that Paul talks to the church in Corinth about is women. Okay, and here's what he says. Don't let anyone say that we don't deal with the difficult topics, okay, that we skip over things. And I understand that this next passage was a topic, some conversation around lunch tables and things like that. All right, so hopefully we can shed some light on it. As in all the churches of the saints, the women should keep silent in the churches. For they are not permitted to speak, but should be in submission, as the law also says. If there is anything they desire to learn, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is shameful for a woman to speak in church. Now listen, women have always had a prominent role in early Christianity in the formation of the church. Think about the cross, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Where were the men? They left. The women were the ones that stayed at the cross with the suffering Messiah. Paul held women in very high regard. He greeted women often in his letters. As you look through the New Testament letters, you see Paul addressing women that he had met, and he called, in some cases, he called them co-workers that would work alongside him. However, there is biblical precedent for women to not have a spiritual or teaching authority over adult men. You can look at 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 through 12 if you want to look that up. This principle is applicable to all the churches, Paul says. Now, it's not because of an intellectual inferiority. It's not because they have lesser value. That's not what Paul is saying. Paul is saying here, by the law, he's referring to Genesis chapter 1 through 3. In creation, God placed an order. He placed structure so that, catch this, men and women would understand their roles, so that they would understand their place and their roles in the whole process of revealing God and of sharing the gospel. It was a clarification of their role as both men and women. Now, Paul's words here are very strong, are they not? I mean, these are pretty bold words. The women should keep silent in the churches, and for it is shameful for a woman to speak in church. Now, I do have to remind you, in chapter 11, just a couple of lines earlier in his letter, he encourages women to share their gift of prophecy and to pray. Remember, I think Pastor Rudy did the head covering, the whole idea of head coverings there. And he encourages them to use their spiritual giftedness within the church. Perhaps, let me give you some possible scenarios as to the strength of Paul's words here. Paul is speaking perhaps here with respect to a larger assembly. The church has come together. And so he's saying that, well, maybe within the church there's a different structure here that in the previous passage in chapter 11, he was talking about smaller groups, where here you have organized public meeting. And he says, in public meetings like this, I do not permit a woman to have authority, spiritual authority or teaching over a man, as he says in 1 Timothy. It's also possible that the women here at Corinth, maybe they were asking questions during the worship service, interrupting the prophetic teaching. Perhaps they were being disruptive. Maybe they were even undermining the leadership of the men at the church, and it was causing problems. They were maybe speaking boldly in opposition to what some of the men were preaching or teaching at that time. It's very likely or possible that Paul is addressing a very particular group of women at the church in Corinth. Here's why I say that. Because remember, in chapter 11, he encouraged them to use their prophetic gifts and their gift of prayer. He speaks of the importance of women appropriately prophesying and praying. This may have had a specific response, all right, within the church. Now remember, in Roman culture at that time, women were property. They didn't have a place in culture and in society, in government. They had no voice. Paul comes on the scene and says, in the church, you are valued in the church. Your gifts are needed within the church. And so perhaps these women that have been restricted in societal restraints, now when they come within the church, the pendulum perhaps had swung too far. They were expressing this freedom that was not given to them in culture and in society, and they were extremely expressive within the church of the freedom that they had had. Again, women were encouraged to use their gifts. That, combined with this new freedom with Jesus Christ and within the body of Christ and the church, lent them perhaps to dominating the conversation or even disrupting the sound teaching that was occurring within the church. Let me be clear. Paul is not saying that women are of lesser value. That's not what he's saying. Paul is not saying that women are unintelligent or unable to comprehend these things. That's not what he is saying. What Paul's focus is here in this passage, in these words, is this. He's trying to reframe the church's thinking, both men and women, away from self, promoting self, drawing attention to self, and towards building up others and the body of the church. And anything that disrupts that, men prophetically speaking, or tongues, or women stepping beyond the bounds, anything that disrupts that, providing chaos and confusion, Paul is seeking to remedy. He's seeking to get them to rethink. He wants them to understand their roles. Men and women have always had roles. We see it in creation, Genesis 1 to 3. We see it in the family, Ephesians 5. And we see it in the church, the role of men and women within the church in this passage and 1 Timothy chapter 2 and 3. Paul is helping them to see their role within the church, thereby bringing about change so that the church is focused on what it needs to do, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ through the building up and encouragement and edifying of the body as a whole. The fourth point that Paul brings about is false teachers. He says, or was it from you that the word of God came? Or are you the only ones it has reached? He's speaking to the Corinthians now. If anyone thinks that he is a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things I am writing to you are a command of the Lord. If anyone does not recognize this, he is not recognized. Paul's kind of giving him a little bit of a tongue lashing here to keep him in line. He's saying, did the truth of the gospel begin here at Corinth, in the church at Corinth? No. Despite how important you may think you are, Corinthian believers, all the gifts that you have, you are not the only church established by God and given these spiritual giftedness. Listen, Corinthians, there's too much self-centeredness, egotism, and selfishness within your church. And I am writing with authority, Paul says, in order to help you correct this misunderstanding. Those that are filled with the Holy Spirit and are true followers of Jesus Christ, you will recognize my words as prophetic and as an apostle, is what Paul is telling them. Anyone that should speak against my words or any of the apostles' teachings, you need to be very suspect and reject that person. What Paul has taught them are commands of the Lord. Paul is not expressing his personal opinions here. He's not sharing his own thoughts. He's sharing what God has laid on him through the power of the Holy Spirit. The truths that the Corinthians had received had traveled from Jerusalem all the way to Corinth in the hearts of the apostles and the teachers. They were commands of God to be obeyed by his people and the church. Anyone that should push against those commands should be suspect. That's what Paul is addressing here. So Paul summarizes in the last two verses. So, my brothers, earnestly desire to prophesy, and do not forbid speaking in tongues, but all things should be done decently and in order. The Corinthian brothers and sisters are encouraged to pursue their gifts, especially the gifts of prophecy. Again, teaching, encouraging one another, words of comfort and consolation to one another. All right? Don't get locked into that idea that that term specifically means predicting the future. Paul's overall summation and point of this text is clarified in these two verses. He summarizes everything for them. Over these last three chapters, he brings it all together. Develop your gifts. Use your gifts. Do not restrict the gifts of others. Teach one another. Don't disregard the speaking in tongues. But everything is to be done decently and in order. No confusion. No chaos. Okay. So over these three chapters, I've kind of formed a list. And basically from this passage, here's what I want you to take home with you today. Here's four things that I want you to take home with you today. One, the church is not about us. The church is not about us. Now, I'm talking about MGBC. We're going to use the Corinthian church as a model, as example, as a picture, and we're going to take a look and we're going to assess MGBC and the church. We're going to look at it today. The church is not about us. Listening is the starting point. Unity is essential. Intentional development and use of our gifts is vitally important. So the first one, the church is not about us. Go ahead to the next slide. These are new coffee mugs that not all of you can have. They are for new attenders. We did talk about maybe starting a merch table or something like that here at MGBC, but these are the coffee mugs that will be placed in new attenders. So if someone comes in or you invite someone and they're here for the first time, These bags are located on a table out and back. Feel free to take one and give it to a new attender. But it says right on there, it has our theme statement, worship God and serve others. Now, don't get me wrong. When you come to worship here on Sunday morning, you all do receive a blessing. I hope that you receive a blessing of some sort. But that's not the intention of what we do here on Sunday morning. Our intention is to worship God and serve others. You think about that statement, worship God and serve others, that doesn't come back to you. It's you worshiping God and you serving others. It's going out. It's going vertically and horizontally. It's not about you. That's why I make that statement, that the church is not about you. Again, you do receive a blessing, but that's not the purpose. If you went through these three chapters, and how many times did Paul say, hey, your giftedness is for the edification of the church, the building up of others, the caring for others. When we come here on Sunday morning, our goal is to worship God and share a word of encouragement to others, to find out the prayer needs of others, to find out the answered prayers of others, to support them, to support and encourage our fellow brothers and sisters. If you're coming here on Sunday morning with this idea that, well, I went to church and so I did my part and you checked off your spiritual list of things to do this week, you've got the wrong approach to what the church is all about. When we walk into the doors of this church, our first thought should be, how can we worship God? And as a result of that obedience to God, how can we best serve others? Which leads to the second point. Listening is the starting point. One way that we serve others is by listening. Three times in the passage that we've looked at this morning, three times Paul says, be silent, be silent, be silent. In his book, Life Together, Dietrich Bonhoeffer writes this: the first service that one owes to others in the fellowship, in the church, consists in listening to them. Just as love to God begins with listening to his word, so the beginning of love for the brethren is learning to listen to them. It is God's love for us that he not only gives us his word, but also that he lends us his ear. Notice that Bonhoeffer says, learning to listen. We have to be intentional. That's why I made the statement, when you walk into doors of the church, we have to change our mindset that this isn't about me, this is about worshiping God and listening to others, loving others, building others up, not going through the motion, but really listening for the needs, for open prayer illustrations, and for future answers to prayer. I'm reminded of the woman that was suffering from the problem of bleeding, and the Gospels record that in her mind, all she had to do was touch the hem of Jesus' garment and she would be healed from this continual lifelong process of bleeding that she incurred. All she had to do was touch the hem of his garment. Now, mind you, Jesus is on his way to heal the synagogue ruler's daughter. He's going from point A to healing this daughter over here, the synagogue ruler's daughter. And in between, he has this interaction with this woman and he stops. He listens to her and hears her story, hears her situation, and he heals her. He didn't see it as an interruption to his day. He didn't see it as being about himself. The process that he was in was for others. That's the mindset that we need to have when we come together in worship collectively. Our text today so often points to the fact that the Corinthians were not listening to one another. Paul says, basically, you're talking too much, whether it's prophetic words or tongues or interruptions, whatever the case may be, you're not listening enough. Which brings us to the third point. Unity is essential. Unity is essential. There was a great deal of confusion and chaos at Corinth. There was a lack of unity. remember in chapter 11 when Paul is talking to them about their communion services, their love feast when they would get together? He says, when you come together to celebrate this wonderful, beautiful picture of what I've done for you, and you all gather together in unity together, some of you are eating before others, some of you are eating all the food, and there are other people that don't have anything to eat. Some of you are coming intoxicated. You're drunk. You're not even eating together, he says. You're all eating in different. He said, that's wrong. That's not being unified. It was division and conflict. Let me refer this idea of unity and connect it with the previous point of listening. Listening has a tendency to dissolve conflict and promote unity. Let me say that again. Listening to others, has a tendency to dissolve conflict and promote unity. Many years ago, my first parent-teacher conference, when I was teaching at Southfield Christian School, first parent-teacher conference, Dr. Ken Hall, superintendent, invited me to the office, sat down, and here's what he said. If you have a difficult, challenging parental conflict in the conference, and things get heated, he said, the most important thing that you can do is attentively and patiently look them in the eye and listen to them. Nothing, he said, will dissolve conflict better than you sitting and listening. Interesting, every year for 21 years in the federal prison system, we would have annual training. It was one of the number one things they said in dealing with inmate conflict or inmate fights or arguments that were taking place within the prison. He says, if you can get them separated and then truly look them in the eye and look at the inmate and listen to them, you go a long ways in dissolving the conflict and reducing the potential anger that's going to be displayed. You don't have to look very far. United States Auto Workers, the union strike, won't even sit down to listen to one another. You see, listening demonstrates respect. Listening demonstrates value and care for another person. When you're actively, intentively, intentionally looking them in the eye and listening to them, it demonstrates a value and a love for them that promotes unity. In John chapter 17, Jesus' high priestly prayer before his crucifixion, he prays this prayer not only for the disciples that are there at the time, but he prays for you as well. I do not ask these things only, but for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. You believe in Jesus Christ through the word of those apostles. This prayer is for you as well. So here's what he's praying, that they may all be one, unified, just as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one, together, unified, I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you have loved me. Notice that phrase I put in caps, so that. The whole idea of unity, of a church being unified, is so that Jesus Christ can be glorified, so that people come to believe in him, so that people will come to understand who he is. It is the mission of MGBC to create and develop disciples of Christ. In order to do that, we have to be unified. To generate followers of Jesus, it can't be done in confusion, in chaos. It has to be done in unity. His disciples, in order to do that, were given spiritual gifts. And those gifts must be engaged and utilized. Fourth point. Intentional development and use of our spiritual gifts. MGBC has a mission. We are called by God to go and to make disciples. In order to effectively do this, we all must mobilize and use our spiritual gifts. We have to know what they are. We have to intentionally develop them, and we have to utilize them. This church, the church, any church, will only be as strong as the collective deployment of our spiritual gifts. As Ryan and Celeste come to close out this morning, perhaps development of your gifts, you need to actively pursue them a little bit stronger. I would encourage you, please, if you haven't already signed up for Forged and Refined, I would really encourage you to do that. Pray through it. Take some information. It's very important that your giftedness is utilized, that the Holy Spirit shows you what it is and it's utilized. And it's utilized in an environment of love and encouragement. And that's what Forged and Refined is. It's others coming alongside you to help you and encourage you. Today's the final day to sign up for this ministry. Your gifts are given to you to make disciples and to be discipled and be a discipler to others. I can think of no better way to empower you than the Forged and Refined ministry that we have. Churches weaken and churches close. Churches fall short of their mission when they do not actively utilize and pursue and deploy their spiritual giftedness in appropriate ways. Father God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this church. I pray, Father, that we will be on mission for you, creating an environment of discipleship, that we will strengthen others, that others will see our unity and see our love for one another, and that they too will desire to become disciples and followers of you, Lord. I pray that as we worship you and as we serve others, that we will be able to complete and carry out what you have called us to do. I give this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
This world is empty.
me on. Lead me on, and I will run after you. Lead me on, and I will
run. As we follow up from this morning, Paul repeatedly indicates that the worshipers in Corinth are to be building up or to edifying the body. So take some time to reflect on this, discuss it with your families, with your small groups, with whoever you're spending time with. What does he mean by this? Dig deeper into this passage. What might that look like here at MGBC as part of our church family? So we encourage you to follow up on our website with some of our follow-up questions and other materials and resources on there. Let's pray together. God, we thank you that we even can, that we have the ability to know you, to follow you. Let that song we just sang be true of our hearts. That's our focus, is to know you, to follow you, to share you with others. Help us to be challenged and encouraged by your word this week. Help us to take seriously this question. What does it mean to build each other up? What does it mean to do this as a church family and beyond? As a big capital C church, as a universal church, what does this mean? Help us to unpack that and to take it seriously. We thank you for this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed.